It's funny. People always be like, don't forget about the little people. It's like, why do they refer themselves as little anyway, you know? Why don't you just get big with me? Feel me? They can see it in my eyes.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of John's Entitled Podcast. I am your host, John, giving you another dip this week. This is the second episode I will be posting to make up for the lack of episodes last week. Did I need to do that? Probably not. Did you ask for it? No. Are either of these two episodes I put out this week any good? I don't know. That's up for you to decide. The first one I posted was with my best friend Jason Skipper. I had a lot of fun doing it, and I apologize if the sound quality was a little wonky. As I had said in that episode, the cord I was using that goes between my microphone to my laptop and all my stuff, kind of taking a shit on me. I have since rectified that problem. I have a new cord. Everything seems to be working just fine. Audio levels and everything working just fine. I guess there's just something that made that a little wonky. So I apologize for the episode with Jason being a little hard to listen to at times. But I did have a lot of fun doing that, and I strongly encourage if you have ever thought about doing a podcast, it's a great reason to just talk to your friends, even if it's just once a week, once a month, whatever it is. It's a great way to basically just keep in contact with someone and gives you a reason to do such. So I listen to a lot of podcasts that advocate starting a podcast with your friends and using it for such an excuse. And while I am one of the probably more annoying people you will ever befriend, in the sense that I keep in touch with as many people as I possibly can to maintain friendships, new or old, I thought it was a great excuse to talk to my friend for about an hour and just kind of bullshit about our past lives and kind of keep it on brand with the fact that it was also music-centric. And that wasn't really for show. That really is how we became friends, and it's still a big part of our friendship, as it still is. You know, going to shows, as you heard Jason make the comment about how he'll go to shows with me sometimes just because he knows that it'll probably be fun, and it's what we do and did. So, like I said, I strongly encourage anybody to go back, listen to that episode, maybe tell your friend to go back and listen to it, or listen to it with your friend, and see if maybe some of those stories don't apply to you guys. Or, at the very least, you know what? Fuck it. Start your own podcast. Put your phone between the two of you, hit record, have a conversation about something, start your own fucking podcast. You'd be surprised that someone will actually listen to it. All that being said, this podcast this week is going to be with Jake from the band Greta Van Fleet. It's going to be a little bit of a shorter interview, shorter episode than I usually do. And the nature of that is because this was for... I only had a 15-minute phoner that I got to have with Jake. They were in the middle of their sold-out tour all across the U.S. And this was a heads... This is basically leading up to the sold-out show they're doing here in Grand Rapids at the Stash. I've made mention of this a few times on this podcast that I do side writing for a local online site called online musical site called Local Spins. Basically, they put the spotlight on local bands, show reviews, which is something I typically do. I've been fortunate enough to do a couple of band interviews and one feature. And that's basically what this was going to be for, was for the feature I'm still sort of currently writing for Local Spins. The big issue with it, though, was the timing of everything. Within a day or two of this recording, I had just kind of a shit week. This is a couple of days after I found out my uncle had a brain aneurysm and was, you know, potentially going to die and all that kind of stuff. And as a result of everything that happened and some other things that happened that I'm not really going to go into, that don't really have any bearing on anything that, you know, anyone needs to know. But long and short of it, I just had a lot of personal tragedies happen within a matter of a week. And it was just, you know, the focal point of where I was at wasn't really to try to sit down and write about a band, especially given a deadline that I had. So we've kind of shelved the feature on the band, which kind of might work out to my favor, as it allows me to kind of have more things happen to the band and allow more of a story to be told. As of now, I'm still kind of picking away at it. It's, you know, about 1,000 words. It's something I want to get done because I promised my editor that I would. But it was kind of nice to be able to take the time to just take care of the shit I needed to and kind of mentally take care of a lot of the shit that I needed to. And so I felt like, you know, there was no reason to not hold on to this episode anymore, this interview, and I could share it. So with that being said, it was a 15-minute phone conversation I got to have with Jake, and I tried to ask questions that would allow me to use it for my writing. So if it seems a little weird, some of the questions I asked, that is why. But I thought that I did a pretty good job of getting some interesting information out of him in regards to the band and a little bit about the recording process of their EP that they had put out recently, and just kind of how the band has blown up out of nowhere. You'll hear me tell the story in the very beginning about how I had heard the band about 4 years ago now at Dirt Fest, which is a local festival it used to be out near Birch Run Expo Center, but I think last year it went moved to Pontiac in the parking lot where the Crowfoot Ballroom is and so forth. So with that being said, I do have a little bit of a backstory with this band and some history with this band before, you know, they became the new overnight sensation, as it were. And I was hoping to get to talk to Jake a little bit longer. That didn't really happen. So I tried to make the best of what I could. And sometimes I think doing these podcasts and getting some of these bands on here and these band people, it's pretty much the name of the game. You just kind of got to do the best with what you can. And while I've never had to do a podcast with a time restraint, this was a good test run, I think, of, you know, how well I could do with a time limit. So this is a conversation that I have with Jake from the band Greta Van Fleet. If you're not familiar with that band, I would suggest going out and listening to their EP, Black Smoke Rising. It definitely wears a lot of its influences on its sleeve. Most notably, you will notice the huge Led Zeppelin influence. I can't help but think that sometimes when you are a younger band that unfortunately you just kind of sound like the things that you listen to. But that being said, I'm interested to see where this band goes in the next couple of years. I think they have the right work ethic. I think they have a good support system behind them between producers, management, and so forth. I think as long as the brothers, there are three of them in the band out of four, I think as long as all of them can maintain their relationship and work well together, I think this band could be one of those bands that lasts for a very long time. With bands like Rival Sons and so forth, I think people want to see a resurgence in that old school rock sound with slightly newer production qualities added to it. So this is my chat with Jake from Greta Van Fleet. Hope you enjoy it. Talk to you in the outro. I'm gonna be pretty easy about this. Like, I'm not gonna ask you the stupid name about how you got your band name and all that kind of stuff. I've found enough of that information, and I can piggyback off of, you know, a lot of other interviews you guys have done. So I'm gonna keep it kind of, I feel a little more unique than everybody else probably has done.
Good. I like it.
Wanted to start off by actually saying that I have seen you guys probably in one of the first shows you actually had played, when you did Dirt Fest about 4, maybe 5 years ago.
Oh wow, yeah, that one was a really long time ago.
You, I had heard
that's really surprising. Where are you based?
Grand Rapids, actually.
Okay. Oh, sweet.
Yeah. So we were out in my soon-to-be wife at the time, and some friends were out in the parking lot having some drinks, as you do when you're at Dirt Fest, and heard the opening notes to a Zeppelin tune, and I told my best friend and my fiance to shut the fuck up, because I wanted to hear what was going on, and who was ballsy enough to start playing these songs, and we came back into the fairgrounds, or the whatever it is, where the festival was going on, and came and watched the rest of you guys' set, and were pretty blown away, and it was kind of amusing because this has been, it just popped up in my time hop the other day because I think Dirtfest is happened usually about 2 weeks ago. So kind of fitting that we're doing this interview and my time hop mentioned that that happened about 4 years ago or 5 years ago or whenever it was.
That's awesome.
So
that's unique.
I was going to say, unlike anybody else who's interviewed you, at least I have seen you before all of this has even happened. So
yeah, that's fantastic.
So I guess we'll kind of start with the person who put on that festival, Matt Dalton. I know you guys were working at 37 Studios for a while ago, and something I had dug up when doing my research for this was that you had said that Highway Tune, which is the song, you know, catching fire right now on terrestrial radio and all that kind of stuff, that you had said that it's one of the band's oldest songs, or at least the riff for it anyway. I was kind of curious, were there any other songs that are, you know, from way, like when you first started that ended up on this EP or have maybe morphed into something that ended up on this EP that you've kind of kicked around for a while?
Yeah, I believe that, you know, it was a long time ago that Flower Power was written as well. You know, that was one that was, I was strumming around in a 12 string and Sam came in and just put some keys on it, and it was probably, you know, it was written in under 15 minutes, and it's going to be a great song. So, yeah, that was an early on song. Flower Power certainly was. Safari was maybe written 3 or 4 years ago. So, yeah, the majority of that EP really comes from songs that we'd written 3 to 4 years ago, or actually probably 4 to 5 years ago, more realistically, and then the one that was written within this year was Black Smoke.
Yeah, it's kind of funny to think of, you know, because everyone's so taken aback by the music and so forth, and it's like, you know, I have having known that the band's been around for a while by some standards, just wondering, you know, like, you know, the, you know, Highway Tune being the song that's catching everyone's attention, it's like, oh, you know, it's interesting to know that that song's been, you know, one of your first ones that you were writing on, and it just took you a while to kind of make it come to fruition as far as writing a full fleshed out song. So it's kind of the nice thing, I guess, about having all this time to make the first EP is you have all that time to perfect these songs.
Definitely, yeah, that's definitely a contributing factor to try to, you know, create a truly great, you know, piece of art and great music. And I think that, you know, recording for 2.5 years where we're recording now has really shaped a lot of the songs.
Speaking to where you're recording, you worked with Al Sutton over at Rust Belt Studios out in Royal Oak. Is that where you're still working?
Yeah, we're still working in and out of there, yeah.
Okay. It's kind of, I mean, and with this being for something called Local Spins for kind of a Michigan music website, we're going to kind of keep it a little bit locally themed. So with, you know, Al being a Michigan native and having worked with other Michigan artists such as Kid Rock and Bob Seger and a slew of other incredible artists as well, not just kind of pigeonholing it just to Michigan artists, but did having ties to some Michigan artists that have kind of put their stamp on the music scene over the last several decades, was that kind of something you were looking for? You know, someone that knew how to kind of work with the sound that you were looking to, that you guys have and will probably obviously continue to keep working on? Is that something that was led you to him, or how did you end up over at Rust Belt?
Yeah, I think that we wanted to we were in Michigan, so we wanted to stay in Michigan, and I think that Al was probably the number one candidate in which we thought would be able to produce the music that we wanted to produce. And so, you know, we met up with him, you know, we called him and sent him some material, and surprisingly enough, he accepted the offer to meet with us, and we had slowly been able to get, you know, got to know him, and he wanted to work on our stuff as we did it. I think it was really inspiring for him and for us as well, you know. So, yeah, that was definitely, we were definitely aiming for Al Sutton and Rust Belt Studios, and I think it's a good marriage of production and songwriting.
Most definitely. Kind of speaking, it's funny, you're kind of leading right into all the questions I have. I either wrote them really well, or you're just kind of mind reading. But you ended up working with Marlon Young, who's also from the Brown Trucker Band of Kid Rocks. How was it working with him on some of these songs, and you know, maybe having him add some little flourishes to some of the stuff you did? Because I kind of felt like Flower Power might have been a great example of something he might have helped you guys with, as far as adding like little nuances to.
Yeah, no, little things in there. Yeah, Marlon is a great interpreter of music, and he can really take, you know, a base for a song's construct and kind of trim the fat, is the way he likes to put it. And he really can. He's a really good, you know, he's got a great ear. I mean, a flawless ear. And so having him, who's been, you know, Kid Rock's band leader for, I think it was over 10 to 12 years, I think.
Yeah, something like that.
There's certainly a lot of credibility where that's from, and he wanted to work with us, and he had heard us through Al. So the last year and a half, he's been in the studio. I think that it was great, both Al and Marlon, you know, working with them for the last 2.5 years. The amount of, you know, because I would see it fit to say that we're more live musicians, you know, more so than studio musicians. But the last 2.5 years working with them, we've learned, you know, an unaccountable amount of knowledge as far as, you know, being studio musicians.
No, for sure. It's kind of funny, you know, you guys talking about being a more of a live band. Frankenmuth is not really known for having a live music scene. So what did the scene look like for you guys when you were trying to start playing out, or did you have to venture out more past, you know, your home area, like your home base, and kind of make a name for yourself, maybe somewhere
there
else?
There really isn't. You know, now there are some things implemented now, like the Friday Fun Nights in Frankenmuth that they do,
right,
which is, you know, has a lot of live music. But before that, you know, it really wasn't much of a music scene at all in Frankenmuth other than the festivals. And so, you know, it was interesting to be like one of the only. There are some other, like Brody and the Bushra Tree and some of those guys and the Bromantics, but, you know, one of the few live bands in Frankenmuth to come from Frankenmuth, so it was certainly unique. And there isn't, you know, at that point wasn't a music scene, so yeah, we did a lot of venturing outside and playing around the Tri-Cities and down in Detroit.
I'm sure playing in Detroit, you know, you guys, obviously all the brothers being big on Motown and a lot of like the early rock and roll stuff that came out of Detroit.
Oh, yeah,
I'm sure that was, you know, kind of nice being able to cut your teeth down there where a lot of your influences came from.
Definitely, yeah. There's no other way to do it. Absolutely no other way.
Kind of speaking to potentially some of your influences, I know it's kind of been beaten to death that there's, you know, three brothers and your drummer, but I kind of have wondered, did you guys as a collective ever really look up to other bands maybe that would have been influenced you, between like, you know, the Allman Brothers and maybe even like AC/DC or Van Halen, and kind of see that a family and a business band kind of thing can work and be successful?
Yeah, I've always admired those because of the circumstances that we're in. You know, it's like I have, you know, a certain kinship to be able to look at other bands that have been family, you know, oriented and say, oh, that's what we're doing. And it hasn't happened until, you know, recently that I've gone, you know, like, oh, you know, this is more of a common thing. And I, you know, I never really thought it to be all that unique because we just grew up together playing music.
Right.
We play together. But yeah, certainly. I mean, certainly, and even the Allman Brothers music, which was influential to all of us, regardless of the family orientation. But yeah, like that, and yeah, I found it really interesting, but now anyway, yeah.
Kind of, I'm sorry, kind of reading my own stuff real fast. it's funny because, like, listening to, like, the Eddie Trunk podcast that you guys did that was released a few weeks ago, and then I think you were on Sixth Sense and a lot of these other, like, classic, you know, rock shows, or hosts and stuff like that, Matt Pinfield. It's been interesting to see that everyone of that ilk is, you know, you're on their radar and subsequently then being put on their listeners' radars and so forth. How do you feel about all this, and I'll say, quote-unquote, sudden attention and success? I mean, what's been the most memorable experience for you guys so far? Because, I mean, it's not very often that...
You know,
go ahead.
Yeah, sorry about that.
No, I was going to say, go ahead.
Okay. I think that, you know, it's certainly humbling and very elating, and I don't think that any of us had expected such an immediate response from what we were doing. And, it's difficult to say. I certainly believe that this music that's being made and the way that it's, you know, a very classic, classically rock influenced, has the ability to be appealing to an older generation based on that was the music that they, you know, grew up listening to.
Right.
And it certainly has an appeal to the younger audience and our own generation, because the majority of our generation hasn't listened to any of that music. So to them, it's very new.
Yeah,
you know, it's very uncommon to them. They don't get it. So when that, you know, a younger kid hears it, they really enjoy it. They take it to their parents and say, "Listen to this. I think you'll enjoy it." And when a parent listens to it and they've heard it before, the first thing they want to do is show their children. So right. I think that there's a broad range of ability to, you know, touch a mass audience. So I think, you know, that immediate attention, all of that may be the credit that that sort of immediate attention has garnered.
What's been the most memorable experience for you guys so far out on the road? You know, I know you guys did a sold out show here at 20 Monroe, like our brand new venue, one of the first sold out shows there, opening for Shinedown,
yeah.
Which was crazy. Cause like, had I known you guys were opening, I probably would have gone, but,
that's awesome.
How has been hitting the road and kind of getting on some of these bigger shows and so forth and seeing, you know, like classic venues like the Whiskey and the Viper Room and all that kind of stuff. How's that been for you guys?
That's been really awesome, really. I mean, it's been fantastic. I think one of the coolest moments for me, and it was like the first time, and I don't think that in particular any of us get stage fright too much anymore, but we did it, you know, another series of shows with Shinedown at, for me, and this is for me personally, I think this is one of the coolest experiences, is during Cherry Fest in Michigan and then Summerfest in Milwaukee, I believe, and Cherry Fest, any show in Michigan, I really, really enjoy, you know, being able to be home and play. And so Cherry Fest in Traverse City was probably one of my favorite experiences up to this point, you know, to see the crowd full of, you know, 30,000 people. And at that point, before you go on, you kind of get some stage fright at that point.
Speaking to playing Michigan shows, you have a show coming up opening for Bob Seger. What was it like getting the phone call for that slot, and what's kind of the anticipation for that?
Well, we because everybody's so tightly connected in the music industry, in Michigan especially, you know, with working with Marlon, we met Pawn Shoes, Bob Seger's manager, and I would assume that he had something to do with this, and we were all absolutely, you know, I think, that may replace the Cherry Festival with the coolest experience. Because that was, you know, I don't think any of us, I don't know if I still believe that it's even, you know, that it's actually happening, because that's a dream come true, you know.
Yeah, totally. When I saw that you guys had gotten that opportunity, I was like, well, there probably couldn't be, I mean, Kid Rock can only play with him so often, we gotta get some new blood in there eventually.
Yeah, right.
Especially before he calls it a day.
I suppose it's fitting, yeah.
Yes. So kind of wrapping up real quickly, we will be seeing you guys coming up in a few weeks playing The Stash. You're currently on basically a completely sold-out tour. What can we expect from this show? And maybe since it'll be technically the first like headline show here in Michigan on this tour, what can fans expect?
Well, you know, I think that there's a large dynamic, you know, within the set now, and we've been able to bring in keys and in the acoustic guitar portion, and hopefully, you know, that everybody gets the large, you know, sort of dimension that we want to fill and kind of showcase a lot of what we've been up to and some of the new songs that we'll be hearing on the next album, or the first album rather, and it's gonna be energetic and fun, man, you know.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Like I said, it's been 4 years since I've seen you guys live,
yeah,
so it'll be interesting
great.
To see.
Perfect, because that's right in Grand Rapids.
Yeah, so it'll be interesting to see I'm not sure if you're familiar with the band Wilson out of Detroit, but having seen those guys play one of their first shows and been seeing them for the last 6 or 7 years or so, and just seeing the band morph into what they become, where they're, you know, opening for bigger bands and on touring, that internationally touring and so forth. It's been interesting to see. So I'm really interested to see how you guys have grown since I last saw you, basically, before you really had even probably been playing out very much. And last question, you guys are, as soon as you're wrapping up this tour, you're heading overseas, I believe, for the first time. So what are you looking forward to most about heading overseas?
You know, I'm really curious to see, you know, there's all of the, you know, ideals of the romantic European destination. So I'm curious to see if that's bullshit or not. I'm really excited to see London and to see Paris and you know, go to Germany and all of these places that I've wanted to go my whole life, and, you know, be able to do it on no other merit other than the music that we've been playing. And I think that's one of the most exciting things, and I think that it'll feel well-deserved or earned to some degree.
It's going to be awesome for sure. And then it looks like you guys will be doing some more touring stateside, and I would assume probably working either on your... I've heard you say you're going to do a full length, but I've also heard you say you're going to do some EPs and then probably mash together a full length out of that. So I guess we'll stay tuned and see what comes out of you guys in the next year in 2018.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
Well, thank you for your time, and I'll let you get back to your day, and we'll be seeing you in a couple of weeks.
All right. Well, thank you. Thanks for the interview, John. Appreciate it, man.
Yeah, not a problem.
I'll see you in Grand Rapids.
There we go. Have a good day.
All right, likewise.
So that was my chat with Jake from Greta Van Fleet. As I said, it was a little bit of a short chat, but I think there was some really interesting stuff that we got to in that little bit of a time frame. Looking forward to seeing what this band does over the next couple of releases. I think the fact that they put out an EP as opposed to a full length kind of does that thing of leaving people wanting more. I know I've listened to that EP a handful of times and usually let it go through and just let it play on repeat because I don't mind listening to those songs more than one time through. So I actually think that it kind of is helping them at this point. Instead of putting out like a 12 or 14 song full length, it's allowing people to get a taste of what they're capable of doing and what the band is doing as of now, but then giving you just a little bit, so you definitely want more, as opposed to being like, man, that's 15 songs, man, there's only like 3 or 4 good ones on this. So I'm hoping that this next set of songs, whether it be an EP, whether it be a full length, I've heard that they basically have a full length worth of stuff done. I don't know if it's going to be released as a full length. I think, based on how, you know, something they had said on Eddie Trunk's podcast a little while ago, was that they plan to do another EP and a full length, or another full length and then an EP or whatever. But in light of something like Jesse Leach from Killswitch Engage posted recently, that the band's kind of looking at doing things differently themselves, whether it be an EP or a song for a soundtrack or a full length or whatever, they themselves are trying to figure out how they want to put out music and what's the best way to do it to keep fans interested. I don't really know what that answer is. I kind of agree with maybe an EP put out every couple of months, but at the same time, I've seen bands do that where they then put out 2 EPs and then marry them into a full length with 1 new song, so it gets people to buy everything. But in today's digital world, I don't really even know if that matters, because, I mean, people just get it off their fucking phones anyway, so I'm not entirely sure what the rollout plan will be for this band, but I am interested to see, being a Michigan native, being that they are a Michigan band, I'm interested to see what this band does, because as I said in the interview and as I said in the intro, this band has been around on my radar for about half a decade now, and they haven't really put anything out. They haven't really played around locally, because, I mean, kind of as you heard, Frankenmuth doesn't really have a scene, so they had to go to Detroit, and, you know, while I was aware of this band, I never really saw them playing a whole lot of shows here in Michigan, and then it just seemed like out of nowhere this band fucking exploded, and we're playing, you know, one of our bigger over 2,000 seat rooms, 20 Monroe Live, here in downtown Grand Rapids, opening up for Shinedown and playing with Shinedown, and then I'm looking at tour dates and seeing that they're selling out like the Whiskey and getting on all these great, you know, festivals and ahead of bands like He Is Legend and other bands that have been around for over a decade, and it's like decade plus, and you know, done some extensive touring and had commercial success. So it's kind of been like, what the fuck, like, how did I miss this? And I was kind of pleasantly surprised to find out from their management, like, I didn't really miss anything. It just literally is happening this fast for this band, and it's pretty crazy to see. Like I said, I saw them play at Dirtfest and literally told my wife and friends to shut the fuck up because I heard them playing, somebody playing the opening notes to Stairway to Heaven, and it was pretty shocking that someone had the balls to fucking play that at a outdoor music hard rock festival, basically. And I really expected once the vocals kicked in for it to sound like shit, and was amazed that it didn't. And I don't usually put drinks down that I start, especially when you're at a festival and you're able to go to and fro as you please. But I put my drinks down and went into the festival, and for the rest of the 20-some-odd minutes that this band was playing, I was captivated. And to see how young they were then, playing music as proficient as they were and as tight as it was, like, it's pretty inspiring. Not only just as a musician myself, but just, you know, as a music lover, and to see that the bands that young are paying homage to the bands that influenced so many, and they're doing it, obviously, kind of with the influence on their sleeve, but I think this band will find soon enough their own groove and how to settle into their sound, and I'm really interested to see how and what that looks like for this band, and I'm interested to see if the hype surrounding this band continues. A lot of people, even on the Talk To Me podcast, when they were talking about Louder Than Life, Joshua and the co-host he had on that day, you know, they kind of shit on the band a little bit and saying that, you know, they're basically the next overhyped band that's going to save rock and roll. And I don't know. It certainly kind of feels like maybe they will. There's a lot of notice being taken by a lot of older people who don't go to shows, who don't support newer bands. So to see that this is what's going on with these guys from an older generation, kind of interested to see where the fuck this goes. I guess, I mean, I've said that so many times already, but I've not seen this much hype behind a band in a long time, so I'm very interested to see what happens with these guys. So I really want to thank Jake for taking the time to talk to me. I want to thank their management for dealing with setting all this up and getting it squared away, and, you know, taking the time to let me interview them for Local Spins and to do the interview as a whole. I know they are insanely busy, and it sounded like Jake was kind of catching a cold. This was done in the middle of their tour, so, you know, anytime, you know, they have free time, which probably isn't very much, given the fact that this band's so big right now, you know, 15 minutes for someone like myself, it's really appreciative. So, socials, you can follow Greta Van Fleet, basically, at their website, just gretavanfleet.com. That's GRETAVANFLEET.com. That'll have links to all their socials, but if you want it done a la carte, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, all at Greta Van Fleet, one word. If you would like to follow Jake specifically, you can follow him on Instagram at Jake_GVF. Pretty much, I believe that's everybody in the band's Instagram handles is their name, _GVF. I think everyone in the band's Instagram handles are basically just that, their name, _GVF. So if you would like to follow them, I believe the rest is Josh_GVF. Basically, you could just go to their Instagram page for the band, and I think it has all the other band people's Instagram handles right there. So again, thank you to Greta Van Fleet and Jake for taking the time. If you would like to follow me and waste more time on social media looking at the dumb shit I do, you can follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at John's Untitled Podcast, all one word. Tweet at me at John's Untitled Pod or email me at johnsuntitledpod@gmail.com. For all the fun things going on or guests you would like me to get or whatever, social media is fun, and I'm trying to be more active on them all and to provide different content for them. Something I've learned from Joe Gal, the amazing photographer out of the Detroit, Michigan area. If you are not familiar with him, quickly become acquainted with him. He is at Camera Jesus on Instagram and I believe Twitter as well. And if you follow him on Facebook, I believe it's just Joe Gal Photography or Camera Jesus Photography. Dude is just phenomenal at taking photography. If you like buildings and landscapes and stuff like that and architecture, I believe some people call it ruin porn, you know, with buildings being all like demoed out and such, but the dude just is doing phenomenal shit right now, and it's always a great follow. And something he does between Snapchat, Instagram Live, Instagram, Facebook, all that shit, he makes each feel unique unto itself. So no matter where you're following him, you're not just getting duplicated content over and over and over again. So I'm trying to borrow a page from Joe and trying to be unique with what I post, where I post it. And I got to say, it's actually a lot harder than you think it is due to the fact that you can just literally have everything copied from whatever, like Instagram, and then just go everywhere else. So it is a little bit more challenging to do such. But Joe is a great dude. I would love to get him on this podcast. I think it'll be a lot harder than I would hope it would be, given the fact that he lives here in Michigan. But dude's pretty chill and keeps to himself. But he's a very great follow across social media as well. So go follow him. That is my plug for this episode. And without further ado, we are going to end this episode with a song by Greta Van Fleet. This is Highway Tune. That is off of their EP, Black Smoke Rising. You can pick that up wherever you listen to your music. It's on iTunes. It's on Spotify. I believe the album's on YouTube. If you go to their Facebook page, I know this video is like the first thing that plays in the background. So pretty much anywhere you go across their socials, you will find a way to check out their music. It is like short but sweet, but I think you will dig it. So without further ado, this is Highway Tune, and I'll talk to you guys next week.